So now we get to the heart of what God is doing and kind of the issue for every day of your life now and a billion years from now. You're going to live that long. There's never going to be a time when you're not conscious of being you. That's a hard thing to grapple with. It's kind of upsetting and scary. You never... The only time you sleep is going to be down here. Once you die, there's no such thing as sleep anymore. There's no such thing as being unaware. To me, that sounds hellish, okay? A lot of the things I end up saying in these audios, I don't like the doctrines. Okay? God's right and I'm wrong, and he does like the doctrine, so I have to learn how to change, but I can still state what they are. That's my own problem if I'm going to be negative to him, okay? And this next bit is kind of what helps get over that hump of negativity, at least for me, and maybe it'll help you too. Do you see what he's doing here? He's threading everybody together in a relationship. That's the key for this audio. Relationship. We got two things that we're constantly struggling with every single day and a billion years from now. Right. That's one kind of R. Right. Begins with an R. Right. Or relationship. That's a different R. And that was basically the struggle that Adam had when his wife ate that fruit, whatever kind it was. Nobody knows what kind it was. Should he go for being right? Or should he go for relationship? That question itself, which is two-pronged, right versus relationship. But then there's another two prongs in each. Right by what definition? God's definition of right? Or the human definition of right? Because it's not the same. Then when it comes to relationship, what relationship? Relationship with the woman? Or relationship with God? So we got two prongs, right versus relationship, and then in each of the two prongs, we got two more prongs. Right by whose definition? God's or your own? Or, you know, human. And then when it comes to relationship, God or whatever the other item is, or person. For example, let's say that I just can't stop eating chocolate cake. Then my relationship with chocolate cake is like, is it chocolate cake or God? So maybe I make chocolate cake my God to try to resolve that problem. See the point? But chocolate cake is not God. So then I'm buying a lie instead of God. So then it's not right, is it? See the point? This, our whole life is just, you know, grab a sheet of paper, okay, and up at the top, I guess we could say up at the top, on the left-hand side, put the words right, human, put human in parentheses below the word right, and then in the upper right-hand corner of the page of paper, put right, God, in parentheses below the word right. Which of the two rights are you going to choose right now? And then below those, okay, you put the word on the lower left-hand corner, put the word relationship. And then underneath that in parentheses, put human, comma, thing. And then the lower right-hand corner, write the word relationship again, and then beneath it in parentheses, God. So on your sheet of paper in the upper left-hand corner, you're going to have the word right, and then beneath it in parentheses, you're going to have the word human. And in the upper right-hand corner of your piece of paper, you're going to have the word right. And beneath it, you're going to have the word God in parentheses. In the lower left-hand corner, you've got the word relationship. And beneath it in parentheses, you've got the word human things. You could say people, comma, things. And in the lower right-hand corner, you've got also the word relationship, but beneath it in parentheses, you have God. Every single moment you breathe, you're choosing one of those squares or a combination of squares. Every decision you make is going into one or two of those squares. You'll notice that they're antithetical. God is not people. So the definition of right that you buy is either a human definition or God's. The relationship that you buy is either a human or things definition or God's. That they're all antithetical. This is what Romans 8 is all about. First 10 verses in particular. You're always choosing between the two, just like Adam had to choose between God and woman in the Bible. What was right for Adam to choose? Relationship, God or her? Right? Well, the right of being with God or the right of being with her. And notice how I'm using the word right. Right has to do with some, what do you want to call it? Power, just deserts that you possess, right? Like you have rights to your computer. Right as in being right versus being wrong. Both meanings apply. That's why this is so complicated. Your right to be with God is something God granted you. God granted it to Adam, God grants it to you. Okay, but now you have to choose which is right, to be with him or to be with, in Adam's case, the woman after she fell. It's an either or, especially in that case. Now, just because it's an either or doesn't mean it stays that way, but you have to choose what's first. What right, God's rights, your rights, God being right, you being right, is that first? Or some human or thing, and you say, well, that's right, I'm choosing, I have the rights to choose that being right. Yeah, you do. And you also have the rights to all of the consequences that go with it. Now, the kicker is that no matter what you choose, you end up with a sort of wholeness, a woven structure of thought pattern that you create and you live by. Whatever you call right starts to govern all of your other decisions. You can change your mind. You know, like if I say, well, it's right that I have chocolate cake and I have relationship with the chocolate cake and therefore I have the rights to get fat and lose my health because I'm eating something that isn't all that nutritious. I can make that choice and then I get the rights to the consequences that go with it. That creates a whole woven structure. Okay? Or I can say, well, I want the relationship with God first. I determine in my soul, that's right for me. God gave you the freedom to make that determination. He has the freedom, so he gives it to you also. And then whatever choice you make, he ensures the freedom of the consequences accruing to you. See, this is what people don't understand about salvation. It's a contract. It's an inheritance contract, according to the Bible. You inherit salvation. Remember, what was it? He just threw that at me. What was that passage? The young man, or the parable of the young, not parable, but the young ruler who says, oh, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Now you can see where the poor guy was confused. He was thinking it was right for him to do something to inherit eternal life. And he was thinking Christ was just a good teacher. Okay, good rabbi means good teacher. Rabbi equals teacher. Good rabbi. In some of the passages, I think it just says rabbi without the word good. And one of them, you know, Christ responds by saying, why do you call me good? Only God is good. To get the guy to wake up, ooh, why am I saying I can do something to inherit eternal life? Only God is good. I can't do anything to inherit life. Duh. See, Christ was begging the question of right and relationship there. The guy was operating in the wrong boxes on his own sheet of paper. He was operating on the left-hand side of the sheet of paper. Christ was encouraging him to look at the right-hand side of the sheet of paper. Because we're all using that sheet of paper every minute. We're deciding what's right, and we're deciding what's relationship. Okay, fine, but it has its consequences that go with it. And, gee, do I really want those consequences? Now, what God's doing is he's weaving all of us together with whatever decisions we make, whatever side of the sheet of paper we're living on. And you end up living on one side of it or the other most of your life. You start living on the right-hand side of the sheet of paper, you're going to get more and more disenchanted with the left-hand side. You start living on the left-hand side of the sheet of paper, it gets harder and harder to want to go to the right-hand side. The body gets in the way. The body is comfortable doing the same thing. It's called the law of inertia in physics. The body in motion tends to stay in motion. Okay, whatever you're doing currently, it gets easier to do the same thing the next minute. That's why we get fat. You get comfortable just sitting, you'll want to keep sitting. In my particular case, sitting is about the worst thing you can do. But once you've been sitting, moving is not what you want to do. First of all, you know, you can tell yourself it's not right to be moving because then you're not absorbing something in your head. Yeah, but see, if your body doesn't work, then your head isn't going to work. See, God joined the body to the head. I yell at him about this every day. Why do I even have a body? Yeah, because he wants to join the high of the low. That's what 1 Corinthians 12 is all about. I mean, 1 Corinthians 12. Body and head, the lower parts, the more ignominious parts. Well, see, that's God joining all four parts of the piece of paper together, right and relationship. See, if you say that God is right and if you say relationship is with God, God's going to turn around and then say, okay, now I'm going to integrate what's opposite me, namely you and everything that you got, into me. So that you can find a motive for being right, a right relationship to everything else because you first got the right relationship to me. Now notice, that's two words, right and relationship. Now we're talking about the vertical halves, not left versus right, but top versus bottom. We are always thinking of God in terms of right, wrong. That's true, but it's not primary. Notice that relationship is in the bottom half of the page. You say, well, that's lower then. Try thinking in a different way. Foundational. Without the foundation, you don't have a building. It's based on relationship that rightness even matters. This is something we're all not getting about, this whole story. When you think of the term God, talk to any atheist, the first thing he starts doing is talking about right, wrong. He's not thinking about relationship. He thinks of God as some kind of authority figure that's all about having power over you. That's not the point. God does not need us for his own power to be his own power. His power precedes, or we wouldn't exist. So then he didn't make us in order to assert power. He already has it. He doesn't need it. When you're happy with somebody, you're not trying to assert power over them. You just enjoy their existence. When you have children or a dog and you're happy, then you're not interested in asserting power over them. You enjoy them being what they are. You're not busy thinking about whether you're superior to them. You might be aware of it, but that doesn't matter to you. When you're eating chocolate cake, if you like it, you're not busy thinking about how superior you are to chocolate cake. You're thinking, oh, this chocolate cake tastes so good. See the point? God is already powerful. He didn't invent us in order to assert power over us, but to your average human, and I've used the atheist as an example, but it isn't necessarily an atheist. All of us, the first thing we think of when we think of the word God is power, authority, the ability to slap you down, and an innate sense that, oh, I'm wrong, and he's gonna, you know, my... We think of the relationship to God in terms of power and right, wrong. We define the relationship as power and right, wrong, and authority. That's totally untrue. You see why? God is not about creating power over you. He doesn't need you to get power because he already is innately omnipotent. If anything, you could argue that he sort of like doesn't give a flip about his omnipotence. He doesn't give a flip about the fact that he's perfect. Because why bother making you and me? So then his first motive for your existence has to be relationship, irrespective of right or wrong. But see, now that you got a relationship with a thing or a person, or especially God, isn't the first thing that comes to your mind right and wrong? And why is that? Because you have the relationship. If you got a relationship with some gal you're married to or dating, you care about doing the right thing for her. If you care about somebody or something, you care about doing it right, getting it right. There's a satisfaction in trying to get it right. But the relationship actually came first, didn't it? If I got no relationship to somebody, I don't care about right or wrong. That person's not even in my mind. I wouldn't even know what would be right or wrong with respect to that person. There's a cockroach. Walking in Venezuela, the cockroaches are pink. There's a cockroach walking somewhere in Venezuela. Not all the cockroaches are pink, but a lot of them are. Really big, like, you know, 3 inches. As big as the ones in Texas. There's a pink cockroach walking around in Venezuela. Okay. Are you busy thinking about right or wrong with respect to that pink cockroach walking around in Venezuela? No. Why? Because you got no relationship to the cockroach. If you had to have a relationship to the cockroach, and then that means you were in Venezuela and somewhere in the jungle where the pink cockroaches are, then you'd be very much concerned about right or wrong. And to you, right would be what? Kill the damn thing. Unless you were, you know, an entomologist, in which case maybe it was catch the damn thing. But you see the point. You're remote from a cockroach. So you don't think about the relationship, you don't have one, and you don't think about right or wrong with respect to the cockroach either. So you see, relationship is what creates the issue of right and wrong. If there's no relationship, there's no issue of right or wrong. Now, the kicker about this is that once you have a relationship and you're busy with the question of right or wrong, it gets all tangled. And this is the trouble we have every single day because, of course, we have relationships with people and things, and especially with our own bodies. What do I do about this body? Do I eat breakfast? Do I go to the bathroom? Which is the right thing to do? And we usually phrase it in terms of best, which is really what right ought to mean. What's the best way to have a relationship with your body? What about the other bodies? You're knocking around this planet with a whole bunch of other bodies. What kind of relationship do you have? And then what, now that you have a relationship defined, rightly or wrongly, what's the right thing to do in that relationship? That's what all of us, every single day, 1,000 times a minute, that's what we're making decisions about. Now notice, we always go to the left-hand side of the boat, or the right-hand side of the boat when we try to decide that. Oh, right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong. And there's all these debates. Right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong. Forgetting entirely about relationship. And notice how opposite relationship is. Who among us doesn't want relationship to be irrespective of right, wrong? Don't we all want unconditional love? Don't we all want somebody to be understanding when we screw up? Don't they want that from us? Don't we all want to have some kind of basis in the relationship where, you know what, you can let your hair hang down. You can be ugly or disgusting, and it's okay. And you can be beautiful and brilliant, and that's okay too. You don't get resentment or envy in reply. We all want that. We will pretty much sacrifice almost anything to get it. And here God gives it for free, and we don't want it? See, that's the point of this whole story. Relationship. Hi, I made you. I don't need a thing from you. You can be whatever you are, whenever you are, however you are, forever. And I still want you. That's why I made you. You're a walking proof that that's true right now. Your very existence. Because God made you. Nobody else could do that. The real you is your immaterial soul. You can't feel, touch, or taste. But when you're dead, you'll know. Okay, but do you have to wait that long? God wants the relationship, right or wrong. Do you want him? Okay, but once you say, yes, I do, I want God, then what happens to the soul? Immediately we get into, oh, am I right? Am I doing the right thing for God? Am I doing the wrong thing for God? Oh, right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong. And what happened? We get so bollocked over right and wrong, we forget relationship. This is what happened to the Jews. This is why Israel rejected Christ when he came. He gave them the Mosaic Law. It was a parody of pagan religion. And if I live long enough, I'm going to show you that in Deuteronomy and Numbers and all that. Every single law in the law is like a ha-ha at the stupidity of pagan religion. Because God's trying to show you, hi, it's not about religion, it's relationship, different R. Because what's religion all about? Right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong. I'm a good person if I do this right thing. So then relationship is cut out. And we all get religious the very second we get into a relationship. Because we don't understand how to handle the right, wrong thing. At what point does it matter to be right? At what point does it matter to be wrong? And if you're right or wrong, well, then what does that do to the relationship? And we're all boxed up over that. God knows that. And what he's trying to do, and I say trying because he's going to let you screw it up if you want, he's trying to show you by learning and living on Bible how to sort through all that. And you get it wrong every day. There's not a day or a minute that goes by that I'm not wrong. I am wrong 100% of the time. Even right now while I talk. I'm also right some percentage of the time. Not 100%. Simultaneously, right and wrong joined together. How come joined together? Because I'm one person, and every moment is a joined moment. Every moment I breathe, I got some ideas in my head that are just flat wrong. And at the same time, sitting right alongside the wrong ideas, wheat and tares, I got ideas that are right. And if they're right, who put them there? God did. So notice, the biggest, most important thing to him is a relationship. The right and wrong question, of course, doesn't even exist until the relationship exists. The relationship is the foundation, the bottom half of the sheet of paper. The relationship is the foundation. So then right and wrong don't have any meaning except through the relationship. And what we're all doing, and I'm no exception, we're all like looking at right and wrong absent, apart from, divorced from the relationship and trying to make our decisions absent, apart from, divorced from the relationship. That's why we don't get anything right, even when we get it right. It was Paul, what was it? He just threw that. Oh, what? 1 Corinthians 13, where Paul says, you know what, even if I have all the doctrines and I have all the knowledge, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. He uses the word nothing in two different ways, the Koine version and the Attic Greek version, uden and uten. First he says, I have nothing, and then he says, I am nothing. Yeah, well, what's the point of being right? See, this is Satan's big problem. He wants to divorce relationship. He wants right divorced from relationship. He wants to go with right first. Hi, I'm right, therefore I earn a relationship with you. No, it doesn't work that way. Nor would anybody saying want it to work that way. Just relationship. God is just God because he's God. Not because he's right or wrong, because he's him. You're just you because you're you, right or wrong. Once you want a relationship with a person, ideally, you want that person to want you the way you want them, and you don't want it to be based on being right or being good. You certainly don't want it to be based on your looks or your money or your reputation or how famous you are or your goodies, do you? Because then how do you know that they love you? Okay, so then being right is a goodie. So how can anybody in his right mind want a religified relationship with God? Oh, I'm right, therefore, God, you should reward me and love me. Really? You don't want that from people, do you? Because if they only love you for how good or right you are, then you're not free to be bad. You're not free to let your hair hang down. You're not free to have failure happen to you. Because then if you insist on your rightness being the criterion of a relationship, getting it backwards, making right the foundation rather than relationship. If you want right to be first, then the minute you're wrong and honey, you will be 24/7. Then they just leave you. So then what kind of relationship was that? A guy is rich and some gal, oh, I love you. And he's dumb enough to believe her. So he marries her. She wasn't in love with him. She was in love with his money. She might have actually thought she was in love with him, but it really wasn't him. The relationship she wanted was with his money, not him. And so suddenly he loses some. So she divorces him and takes him for the rest of his money. And only then he finds out that the relationship she wanted wasn't with him. That to her, rightness meant money. Yeah, and how happy is he going to be? See, God doesn't want us for our money. We don't have any. And do you want to want God for his money? Then it isn't God you want. And that's what religion does. Religion reverses the top and bottom sides of the paper. Just turn your piece of paper, if you wrote on it, like I said, upside down. Yeah, now your whole life is upside down too. Right is your foundation, but all the values are upside down. Notice how the left side becomes the right side when you turn the page upside down. So now on the right side and upside down, you have relationship at the top to humans and things. And at the bottom, right-hand corner, the foundation, you got right being human. Me, I am right. This is what the old sin nature is. If you want proof that the garden, that Adam and the woman in the garden occurred, just look at your own urge to be right and good. That's what the sin nature is. The Energizer Bunny. Ba-bam, ba-bam, ba-bam. Me be good, me be good, me be good, me be good, me be right, me be good. Really? Now, that creates an integrated hypocrisy, doesn't it? Religion is nothing if not an integrated hypocrisy. Everything is upside down and everything is me, 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 me. Human, 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 human. Do good, be good as the foundation of your life. And all relationships are supposed to be based on how good I am. Yeah, and how happy are you ever going to be? Not. Now, turn the piece of paper right side up again. We start out upside down. If you slowly turn the page from being upside down to right side up, that's what living and learning on Bible does to you. Okay, notice how he's changing right from being in the bottom right-hand corner and upside down into being in the upper left-hand corner, right side up. So your cornerstone, right lower corner, is him. Just because. Then right, well, it's on top. Line on line, precept on precept, day after day. And all the other corners are getting built too. But the relationship with him is first. Foundational. At the bottom. So that when the storms of life hit you and the whole superstructure of your house is taken away by a hurricane in life, you still got him. He still got you. You still got the relationship, and ain't nothing gonna shake that. See, building your house on sand or building your house on the rock of your salvation. But the only way that's gonna happen is learning and living on Bible. Why? Because that's Christ's own thought pattern. Old Testament is thought pattern as God. New Testament is thought pattern as human. I mean, I'm not even sure you could say that there's a Bible verse directly saying that. But if you add up all the verses or just talk to God to ask you to show you where the verses are, because of that relationship, he'll show you where the right verses are. Ask him. Peace out.